Good afternoon, open source community, and welcome back to KubeCon Cloud Native Con here in London, England. My name is Savannah Peterson, bringing you all the best stories from the show floor with the fabulous Rob Strecce. Rob, we get to talk, we're really sinking into the networking here.
We are, we're getting to understand, I think, the next layer down or up, depending on how you look at it, with APIs and how all of this comes together, and I'm really excited about this because this is something I'm going to learn about for the first time, so I'm very excited.
Same, same. It's always a joy to get to learn with you, Rob. And who better to teach us than Marcus Kimmerle. Thank you so much for being here with us today. I know it's a busy week.
It's a very busy week, and it's a pleasure to be here.
So, since we're also learning, tell us about the project.
So, it's all starting about telco capabilities. The telco operators have very interesting functionalities, capabilities, which today's developers can use to improve their use cases, their applications, or even create new ones. And the difficulty is that telco is very complex and special. And it's different from operator to operator. You have different vendors, you have different topologies. And to simplify the world, we have started Camara. Camara is just an open source project, an organization to standardize simple API. So at the one side, we create an abstracted layer, a very simple layer, because developers want to have it easy, easy to consume. And we want to hide all the telco complexity and diversity. And that's the reason why we have started Camara. And we have done it in an open source project, because telcos typically do it in a SDO organization, and it takes 3 or 5 years until you have a paper. And then the whole thing is gone. So this time, we are doing it by code. We are standardizing by code together with the developers that we create the best APIs.
And these APIs are for a lot of the things, because I mean, we were talking with LF networking, and there's a whole lot, but these APIs are so that data exchange can happen even network to network or within the same network, because like you said, many of the telcos have multiple vendors, not just one, and maybe they have some cloud native or some RAN and some other stuff that isn't the same as their core network. These APIs cover a pretty broad set of functions. How do people use those APIs?
Yep. Let me tell about an example, quality on demand. So a developer can come to us and say, look, from my mobile phone to the service in the internet, please give me the best connection, please make it reliable, please give me the lowest latency you can. So that's the intent-based simple API what we have. And then the operators now have to work on it and fill it with technical things like slices, like prioritization, like cell IDs, like all the things what are needed. And if the device moves to a Wi-Fi, we have to talk to the router. So all these technical things are done in the background and just to make it happen for the developers. And that's only one example, so quality in demand. To improve the connection, we have a lot more, like APIs to simplify authentication. Yep. You all know these nice SMS with the 6-digit code or with the link, the nice link which can be used for phishing. We won't get rid of it. We can do it in the background without that, because we use the SIM card as a second factor. And simplifies it very, very much. It's a better user experience, it's more secure. So that's also a big area. Fraud is a very, very interesting topic. We know so much about devices, about the location, about the subscribers. We can use of these capabilities to give a warning out, look, that could be fraud. So, next example is location. We know where the devices are. So we can send out a notification if one device comes close to another one. For example, we have security cases where you need that, unfortunately, but we have also logistic cases where a company is interested to see if a device, a car, comes close to a store to prepare the on and off loading.
Right.
So a lot of examples where these APIs can be really helpful.
Yeah. Okay, you just said something that hit me right in the chest as someone who has had to re-log into our video platform numerous times this week. You're telling me my SIM card can be 2FA? Like, that's actually a thing we can do Is that?
For the network, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. That could be a second factor.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah. So you won't have to put in the code ever again for all of us. That's okay. Sorry, that's very cool. I'm just having a personal moment. What you're talking about me? I don't know. When we said we were getting to sit down and learn, no, it's great. I'm loving it. I'm a little newer to the networking game than some of the folks on our team. Shout out to Babla Liberté, and I just think that's really cool. So, I would imagine you're working with telcos all around the world. Are the challenges similar, or are there some geographic specifics that you have to deal with from a compliance, sovereignty, and everything else perspective?
Yeah, there are differences for sure.
Yeah.
For example, in Japan, a tsunami API could be very useful, but in Switzerland, you don't need it.
Yeah. So
more an avalanche.
At least not yet.
At least, but yet.
Yeah. Depending on what happens with the climate, you know.
But that makes it very interesting. We have now more than 1,270 people in Kamara working on 60 APIs, and they are coming from 430 companies all over the world.
Wow.
And it's so exciting to have calls with them. So in the morning to have calls with the people from more China, Mongolia, from the Asian region. And then in the evening, it is Uruguay, Guatemala, Mexico, so it's really nice to work with all these cultures.
Do you find that the community comes together because this is something that they want to solve, and that's like the developers that you're recruiting in here from the community, are they really deep in the tech of the telco network, or are they more general full stack development that is at one of these companies? How what are the types of people that make the best community members and contributors?
Ooh,
so we have three types of developers.
Yeah.
So we have the ones who want to use the APIs. They should not need to know anything about telco. They can just use it, and it should be simple and easy. So that's the one group. The second group is working within the telcos to create the APIs within one telco. And they are for sure, they need all the knowledge. That's very clear. And then we have the third group, which is Kamara. So all the people working in Kamara, working on the APIs, they should have both. Because we want to follow the voice of the customer, the voice of the developer. We want to create the right API, the best API. And for that, this conversation is very, very key.
I love that you're looking at the developer first in that way and being so community focused, not surprising, obviously, given where we are and what you're doing. How frequently, what's the feedback loop like with your community? How often are you talking to them?
It's ongoing. So Kamara is an open source project, and below that we have sub-projects for each of the API groups, categories.
Nice.
And these people are meeting in a different sequence, and it's up to them. So if there is a real demand, it goes faster. If not, it is slower. It's open source, it's simple, driven by contribution.
And transparent.
Do you find that helps? Because when you're talking about telecom, there's a finite amount out there in the world. I mean, yes, there's new ones that are cloud-based that come up and things of that nature, but do you find that you can get buy-in easier because of the fact that so many, like you said, over 400 are members and part of the community, but getting that buy-in is not as hard because everybody's trying to solve the same problems?
I think we have achieved a mindset that telcos are not competitors, they are partners in this topic. And we only win together. And that's different to other areas. So only if we have the same API in every network, in every country, it makes sense for a developer to implement it. So it only scales if we follow that plan. And so we win together. It's easy.
Yeah. Wow, that's actually pretty cool. So it's only scales if you agree. And that is very contrary to the traditional telco market as a whole. I always think that's one of the things that's really special and unique about open source in general, is there's truly this stronger together. And we're at such an important time right now between AI, the explosion of data as a result, and everything else that's going over the network and that people are using. I mean, we have to agree, or else these systems would be breaking down in really funky ways all over the world. When we were talking before we went live, you gave me a little bit of the backstory on the name, and I think you should share that with the audience, because that's fun and I want them to learn some Greek as well.
Yeah, it was a little discussion in the early beginnings how we name the topic, and we decided to do Camara. Camara is a Greek word, and it means roof. So we want to be the roof, the umbrella for all the developer-facing telco APIs, mobile, fixed line, edge cloud, any kind of IT data APIs. It's part of Camara.
I like that. So you can protect them from all the elements and everything else.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah, I like it. I dig it. We've been wondering about the sourcing of the names. Your
yes.
favorite being Rama Llama.
Yeah, Rama Llama is. Anyway, but when you one of the things, because I looked at the API set, because there's over 60, like you said, and one of the ones that caught my eye and was blockchain public address. How is blockchain and these types of technologies really influencing? It's on the payment side and also security, or is it how, you know, because it's a public chain?
It's in the moment you only have this one API,
yeah.
and it's just for the billing.
Okay.
So we wanted to carry your billing that you can buy little things and do the billing using the mobile bill. That's a simple thing.
Excellent.
And for that we also use this blockchain technology at the end. The more interesting is now AI, really, because it's complementary to our APIs, and it helps us to build better APIs. A lot of things where we are asked is prediction. So how will the network behave if I move 1 kilometer, 5 kilometers, 10 kilometers, or how will it be in 1 hour, in 2 hours? This prediction is a very asked thing, and we can use AI to give a better result. Second, AI is also a business opportunity for us because we can create a large language model and provide it via APIs as model as a service. And number three, we love to have our APIs in the big large language models as agents so that they are called from the large language models. It's a business opportunity for the telcos.
Right.
So it's really complementary and working hand in hand.
Yeah, I was going to say,
yeah,
one,
makes a lot of sense.
One of those APIs that I found very interesting was the population density data.
Yep.
That to me makes a lot of sense because especially if you're a telco, you want to understand how many connections devices do I have in a certain area? Do I need to add coverage? Do I need to move things around? But it also becomes that selling opportunity back to people who are trying to say, I want to do geolocated marketing and things of that nature. Do you see that outside the telcos are asking for this kind of data as well, and are they trying to influence where Camara goes?
For sure, we are in contact with reselling companies, with store companies, because they are very interested to send location-based advertisement to the customers to
right.
pull them into the stores, and even if the customers are in the store, to direct them to the right areas and show them, look, personally, Marcus, there is something special for you. So this personalized advertisement is a very big topic where we can help. And our location type of API has some advantages to GPS. It's working indoors, and it's also working if GPS is gone. So
it would work in here?
Yeah.
When we're trapped inside
it's
a conference center and we have no connectivity,
yeah, for sure.
Which is pretty much all the time.
And that, because that, it's using the radio network
yes.
to triangulate, right?
Yes.
And that's
yes.
how it's working. So I think, to me, it's that the whole
It's cool, it's
thing,
smart.
The other one that got me, that I really liked, and I, for various reasons, know your customer age verification.
Yeah.
Which is very important,
KYC,
especially from-
KYC, baby, big
yes,
deal.
It's very, very, you know, especially when you look at what's going on in the world and all of the different things that people could get into, that had to have been one of like the ones that people are like, we need this because we need to block content or what have you and things of that nature.
It's pushed in these days because in the US and several of the US countries, there is a new law
yep.
That special services in the internet are only allowed if you have an age verification.
Yes.
So we need the check, is the person older than 18, yes or no, and then they can access the special sites or not.
Yes.
But even to buy alcohol, to check if a person can go to elections, if it is already 16 or 18 or 21. But even it's more important for me, for the senior people, you can get discounts when you reach 65. So this API is a very, very interesting one.
Yeah. Well, and it creates an experience of surprise and delight for the community and folks that don't even know what's going on inside that and why it's working. This is cool. I could go a lot of different directions right now.
And I've made also personal experience with my first API. So we started in very early days with quality and demand. And we had a good relationship to BMW. And we used a use case where we had to remotely control a car in a parking garage. And to make this connectivity really reliant and lowest latency, we used the quality and demand feature.
Wow.
And I was sitting in this car, no driver in, and what we have not known, it was in the middle of Munich, in the best area, Schwabinger Tor.
Oh yeah.
And in the parking garage, it was full of Ferrari, Lamborghini, Bugatti. I was sitting in the back seat, crossing my fingers that nothing happens, and I was so happy that all went well. Yeah. So that was my personal experience. I could really feel the API with my body and the value of it.
And your personal safety and the insurance for those vehicles and everything else in that moment. Yeah.
But that was my moment when I say, oh, there's really value in.
Yeah.
Oh, I love that. I was going to ask if you were a little nervous sitting in the car when you mentioned it. I'm glad you went ahead and answered that question for us. All right. So, and we're big Munich fans over here, so we're familiar. I knew if I didn't say it, you were going to say it. So, what do you hope to be able to say, let's call it a year from now when we're in Amsterdam at KubeCon, that you can't yet say today? How do you hope it evolves?
Yeah, well, we have the first APIs out, which is really great.
For me,
these APIs are still too technical, too basic, too telco. So if I have a wish, I would like to intensify the communication with the developers to get really what they want, what's the value, what they need. Look, for example, in this fraud area. We have now 15 APIs where you can have 15 different aspects of fraud, but I think that's not what a developer wants.
No.
He has simply one question. Is it fraud, yes or no?
Right.
And if yes, please give me arguments, because I have to tell my customer that I deny the credit.
Right.
So, and that's a simple thing. We have to bring it to this value. And I think it's really now time to intensify this communication to build the best APIs and concentrate on the value. And hopefully in 1 year, we have it.
Great. Well, we will definitely have you back on the show to talk about it, Marcus. This has been way too fun not to. Thank you.
You're welcome.
And thank you. I saw you geeking out like properly
Again, something I learned today, and now I know where it is, and I'm going to take a look.
This was a cool conversation. I really can't wait to hear the updates next year. This is going to be so fun, or maybe even in Atlanta. Yeah. I hope all of you enjoyed this as much as Rob and I did sitting here with Marcus. We're in London, England at KubeCon, Cloud Native Con. My name is Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news. Mm-hmm.